All right, Orlando Magic fans, ladies and gentlemen, we are very happy to announce that we have the unicorn, Jonathan Isaac of the Orlando Magic on the podcast here. Jonathan, thank you so much for taking the time out. How are you doing, my man?
My pleasure, John and Luke. Thank you for having me. I'm doing good. I'm doing great. Appreciate it.
Yeah, man. So I was listening to plenty of interviews over the past few days. I've got nothing else going on. We knew we were having you on. Wanted to be prepared. And one of the things was, Magic fans know, the running thing with you is, how tall is J.I.? Because it seems like you entered a 6'10", you grew a little bit. We really weren't sure. So can you set the record straight for us here on the Six-Man Show? Are you 6'10"? Are you 7 foot? What are you at right now?
You know, I think I've always been over 6'10", but I just said it just because that's what I was used to saying all the time. But I'm pretty much on basis of like them measuring me, like 6'11 and three quarters.
Gotcha. So we finally got it, Jonathan. We got J.I.'s height.
You guys can run with it.
Well, I think it is because, like, if you look at you and Mo, right, you guys are both enormous. Like, I'm just, to put it frankly, like, consider to the average person, but I think it's your hair that just makes you look so much taller than, like, Mo or Vooch and those other guys and everything like that. But, you know, being with this quarantine, we did also want to ask, because we know that you have family, you know, in the Bronx, in New York City. How is your family doing right now, Jonathan? How are they managing, you know, what it right now is like the epicenter of this pandemic in the U.S.?
Yeah, thanks, guys. My dad is really the main one in New York. So he's here with me in Orlando. But I have some cousins and another brother and sister in New York, and everybody's doing okay. So everybody's okay. They're pretty much bunkered down, just waiting for this thing to end.
That's awesome, man. I'm glad to hear that, definitely. So we're going to get right into some of the on-the-court stuff. We would be completely remiss and fail all the fans if we didn't ask some basketball questions. We've got Jonathan Isaac on the line here. So first and foremost, it's been about a little over 4 months now since we've seen you on the floor due to the knee injury. So first and foremost, how's the knee? How's rehab coming? How are you feeling?
The knee is doing fantastic, getting better and better each and every day. Rehab has been, it's been a little different just because of the whole arena shut down, but I've been, the team is taking care of me. They brought me a bike, they brought me weights, and I just kind of get it in every single day, do my bike workouts, my weights on my knee to make sure everything is going smoothly. But I'm really happy about where I'm at.
So kind of jumping into, you know, kind of shifting gears to something else is kind of now there was something I saw the other day that said, I think you're doing an interview with NBA TV at the rookie day photo shoot. Yeah. And they said to you, you know, what do you think you bring to the team, to which you kind of touched on guarding all five positions on the court and priding yourself in defense in that respect, which we've seen reign true as Orlando fans since you've been here. But then you talked about, you know, you'd like to put on some weight, would be kind of your weakness, so to say. And so since then, we've seen that happen, and we've seen you put that weight on. Are you happy with where you are in terms of your weight and what you've put on? Do you want to do more? Is there another weakness that you have that you're kind of prioritizing now? Can you guys tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I would say absolutely still trying to put weight on. I'm trying to make another big jump this summer, and actually this kind of pause helps that. So make another big jump in weight this summer, try to get to like 240. I'm around 225, 226 right now. So being able to get to 240 is going to be really good for me. And yeah, that's probably much the biggest focus of the summer.
Right. Yeah. I think Josh Robbins reported last summer that you came into the season around 234 or so. And obviously as you get into training camp and a lot of the conditioning, some of that weight is going to come off. But what are some of the challenges right now as far as this quarantine? Obviously, you can't go to the store every time you would like to. Obviously, like you mentioned, you don't have full access to the team facility. So right now, what does a typical day look like for you? You're trying to rehab the knee. You're trying to, you know, put on some extra weight if you're able to do so. How are you navigating this quarantine from that aspect, Jonathan?
Well, actually, the pause actually helps that, just because, you know, the team is doing a great job. They, Zach, our nutrition guy, dropped off a bunch of shakes yesterday. So the team is doing a great job. I got my equipment. I can knock out my workouts pretty much every day. So I wake up, I start my rehab. It's a pretty tedious, kind of strenuous process, just because rehab is like a lot of the same repetitions and everything over and over again. So I get up and I knock that out. I do an upper body lift and a bike workout like every other day. to kind of stay on point. And I'm eating just as many meals, so I'm okay in that regard.
Yeah, and also just to kind of shift gears again, you've got a lot of exciting stuff happening. There's a pause in the action in sports, but it seems like for you, that has not stopped. Your life is still going. It's still busy. You're doing a lot of stuff with Project Life and Jump Ministries. So if you would, like, just please inform the viewers who may not know what kind of journey you're on in that and helping them and supplying food and things like that.
Yeah, so Project Life is an organization that I've worked with from time to time. Last summer, we went to Trinidad. They took me to Trinidad, and they put on a food festival out there for the people. So now they're just trying to do something else with everything that's going on. So I'm just kind of the face and helping push it. But from Monday through Friday, I think this is the third week is going to end, and they're going to continue to do this until the coronavirus is over with. But Monday through Friday, breakfast and lunch, kids 18 and under will be able to come up to Jump Ministries Global Church and get a hot plate of food. It's a grab-and-go style. They're trying to, you know, everybody's wearing masks, everybody's wearing gloves, and they're also dropping off plates of food to extended stay hotels and different, you know, poorer areas of Orlando. And I think at this point, it's about 3,000 meals they've given out so far. So they've been doing a great job in impacting the community. And every Friday, they're handing out a box of non-perishables to families that should last them about a week. So they're just really focused on making sure families and kids don't go hungry during this time. Because with the shutdowns, kids aren't really getting their food from school. And some families can't afford to kind of buy two, 3 weeks of groceries in advance. So they're just trying to stand in the gap and do that. So I've just been helping push it. I'm the least important person. They're the ones on the ground doing all the work. I'm just trying to use my face to push it.
Yeah, man. And that stuff is so cool. I was watching that video today where you were explaining that this stuff, the food will last for a whole week,
yeah.
Which you think about it, you know, you can just say it and just in one ear and out the other, but for food to last a whole week for a lot of families, that's a blessing.
Yeah,
absolutely. And people who right now have so much going on that they just like they don't have time to think about where's my next meal going to come from. That type of stuff is so huge. And Jonathan, if you could just kind of tell us, if fans want to get involved, listeners of the podcast want to get involved, how can they do that and help out Project Life and Jump Ministries?
Thank you. You can head to projectlifenow.org. That's the Project Life website. They have the detailed thing of everything that they're doing. You can donate. You can also bring non-perishables to Jump Ministries Global Church Monday through Friday between 8 and 4 if you want to drop off anything like that. I've been going to the store almost every weekend just buying in bulk non-perishables for the kids to eat and for them to hand out. So I've just been me trying to do my part.
And right now, you're someone who does like to be involved with the community.
Yeah.
And right now, we, as you know, and as you've talked about, we have these guidelines that we're having to adhere to from the CDC, you know, staying 6 feet apart, being in groups less than 10. As someone who is so used to being in the community, are there any, besides the obvious of not being able to interact as closely with people, are there any challenges that you've run into during this time that you have to approach things differently than you would normally?
Yeah, it's difficult, man. You know me, I'm used to being out. I'm used to interacting with people when it comes to just anything like this, when it comes to church. But kind of no more pictures right there with people. just trying to stay my distance. And, you know, as much as, you know, you don't want to live in fear, you want to be wise and, you know, adhere to everything and make sure everybody's being safe. So it's definitely different for me personally, but I'm okay with doing it for the sake of making sure everybody stays safe.
Right. And another thing, just to kind of harp on your work in the community and what you do and kind of your passion that everybody has seen for the community and for people, how would you say it's no secret and you made it known that you are a Christ follower. And how does your faith impact your work in the community? And I've really just been curious, did it start when you were younger? Have you always just kind of been instilled with this want to help others? Or did that come along when you met Christ and what does that look like for you?
Yeah, I wouldn't say it was always something ever since I was a kid. I grew up in the church, so I've always had a background of knowledge of who Jesus was and what it is to go to church and to be a Christ follower and all that, but it wasn't really something that I held on to. But I guess I've always been a pretty kind of just low-key guy. And I try to be a people pleaser and help people in any way that I can. But when I did kind of go all in and really submit myself to Christ and get myself planted in the church, it really did all change in terms of just the recognition of, man, I really have been blessed to be a blessing. And when it comes to the community, man, a big part of it is like when everything is going on, when it's the chaos of just the world in general. This coronavirus is one thing, but we're always in some type of panic about mm-hmm. something going on. I see it as just like the firefighters, just like the policemen. The church has a job to do. We have a job to stand in the gap in the community and kind of help when we can. And we are at peace for our lives in terms of we're not afraid if it is to die, if it is to do anything. We're not afraid. We live in faith and love. So to be able to do this, I wouldn't feel comfortable, and I know the church wouldn't feel comfortable just sitting on our hands. Even though it is wise to be completely safe, so we're doing all that stuff, making sure we're safe, masks and gloves. But we have to do something, to help.
I love that answer, Jonathan. And I want to take this as an opportunity to kind of segue. And, you know, a big part of the reason that Luke and I were so excited to talk to you is because for as young as you are, and we're not much older, but just the example that you've set really since coming into the NBA, the example that you've set for young men, but also young Christians, right? The boldness that you have, the confidence, the calm that you speak with, you can just tell that you have the joy and the peace of the Holy Spirit, you know, in your presence at all times. So I just cannot commend you enough on that. But something that I've always wanted to ask you, right? So we all, you know, have different workplaces and things like that we try to navigate, you know, our daily lives, living as Christians, trying to live out the example of Christ the best that we can. So what do some of those challenges look like for you being in the NBA, and what advice would you give to a believer that is coming into the league?
I would say the advice that I always get and that I always draw to is wise as a serpent and harmless as a dove. So when I think about kind of walking out my faith in my workplace in the NBA, it's not something that's easy to do with just the culture of the NBA, the culture of the world, period. So I try to live it. I don't want to say more than I say it, but I want my faith to be acknowledged in the things that I do and not just the things that I say. So I try my best to live a life that represents Christ and who he is and what he's done in my heart and my life. And it absolutely is a process. It's not a one-stop shop thing. I try to represent myself. And if that is, listen, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to go here. I'm not going to say this. I'll say this. I'll go here. I'll do that, and try to live my life in a way where people can say, okay, I see what you're doing and I respect what you're doing. You're not preaching at me. You're not telling me I need to go do this and that. But I respect it. And people do respect it. That I've noticed. So my thing is just getting it in my heart to where I walk it out more than I talk it. And at the end of the day, I see it as something that I have something that people need, and people really do need it as much as we try to, kind of make it look like everything is okay. And people really do recognize and see. And I know that in my life, I've had people who impacted me when I was a younger person, that it wasn't until years later that I had a conversation to say, man, what you did back then, you didn't say anything to me, but seeing how you lived your life, it impacted me. So I'm not really focused on, man, I need to do something right now. This person needs to get saved right now. All that stuff. I want to live my life in a way. And you see that stuff come back on the back end.
I love that. I love the example, like you said, that you're trying to be that example in what you do, not as much as what you say. Another thing that I wanted to ask you is that you've been very vocal about the fact that in one of your sermons, you made a reference that you and your life was the circle and Jesus was that dot. If you guys haven't watched that, you can find a lot of the sermons that John...
Appreciate you, man.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. But you made that reference. So when was the point I'm guessing it came sometime after you joined the Magic, where Jesus became that circle and you became the dot.
Yeah, I would say your timing is right. The experience for me was, sorry, one second. The experience for me was, I think I said it, I stated in the sermon, I kind of had my faith in my back pocket to where I would go through life. I grew up in the church, so I knew things. So I would be living my life, and then when times got tough, it would be what I would relied on. So I go back and I say, "Oh God, if you get me out of this, I had a bad game. Let me pray. Let me do something like that." That's how I would live my life, and it would kind of be this cycle of, you know, falling on the grace of God, getting back and kind of forgetting that I just did and just living my life the way that I saw fit. And it wasn't until I remember I went to chapel one time and the chaplain said Luke 6:46. So shout out to Luke. Luke 6, the verse, and it says,
not the same Luke, not the same Luke.
It says, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I say? And that verse, for the first time, it's the first time I heard it, it really penetrated my heart and kind of seeing like, man, I do kind of, if someone was to ask me today, I would tell them that I'm a Christian, but I'm not really living that life. I don't really care very much about what Jesus has to say about this, about that, about that. I'm not really living my life in the confines of his word. And it just started to mess with me. And I kind of went on this journey of, man, God, reveal yourself to me. And in circumstances and situations and just getting in his word and learning and growing, he did. And now I understand that those things in terms of, you know, people say, you know, God's trying to take away your fun. God's trying to do that. But just like a parent, you know, they want the best for you and they want you to live the best way. And Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have life more abundantly. And amen. I thought, man, in doing what God is asking me to do and pursuing him, my life is becoming more and more abundant. So I want to continue to do that.
Yeah. And I was talking to Jonathan the other day and I said, man, we're in such unprecedented times. The fact that, you know, normally the church or Christ followers or even just everyday people, you look at someone, you ask them, hey, what have you been up to? What's on your heart? What are you struggling with right now? For the first time in probably the history of the universe, we all can say, oh, not much. We're just at home. Yeah. We're struggling for food. My wife lost her job. My husband is struggling, you know, working from home with kids, or, you know, we've all got the same mutual problem.
Yeah.
And I think right now the one thing we all lack is hope. Mm-hmm. I think that a lot of people struggle with that. So with that being said, what do you tell people, or what's your message for people right now who think that this is the deepest the valley is going to get and they're never going to see that peak again? What is your message for those people, and what's kind of that message of hope that you yourself are clinging to right now?
I'm actually going to be speaking tomorrow night and live on YouTube and jgntv.com. And my message that I'm talking about is peace. And, you know, the Bible's kind of version of peace isn't just like the beach, tranquil, everything is fine, you're relaxed. It's peace in the midst of a storm. And how do you find peace in the midst of a storm? You have to have your foundation, your trust in something that lasts or that can't be touched. So if my peace or my trust is in my job, once my job is touched, then my peace is gone. So everybody in the world, like you said, is affected the same way right now. In different aspects, but a lot of the same way. They're not at peace at what's being touched in their lives. Their job is being touched. Their money's being touched. Family members are dying and all that. So how do you find peace in the midst? And you go to, I think it's Matthew 6, and the disciples are in the boat with Jesus. And the winds are starting to take over, and they're going crazy. They're panicking. And then what do? They run to Jesus, and they say, Jesus, we're afraid we're going to die. And Jesus says, you have little faith, right? So it's like, how do you find peace in the midst of a storm? You trust God. You believe the word of God. You get back to the word of God that says all things work together for the good of those that love the Lord, that says he'll never leave us or forsake us, that says take heart. Even though you'll have troubles in this world, I have overcome the world. Those are the words of Jesus. So I try my best to get those words into my heart and choose to believe them over what the world is showing. And I understand that with Jesus, it's eternal, right? Everything else in this world is temporal. I can put my trust in my job. I can put my trust in my health, and all of that is temporary. At the end of the day, we're all going to die at some point, this COVID-19 is going to be over and life's going to go back to the way it was, but something else is going to come that's going to try to steal your peace. But if your trust is in something that's truly foundational and eternal, like Jesus is, you'll be able to stand the test of time. And we can learn from the disciples, right? In this instance, their faith was grown by them running to Jesus and Jesus rebuking the winds and the waves. They said, wow, who is this man that controls the winds and the waves? And their faith was strengthened. So we can follow suit just like them and say, man, we got to run to Jesus. We got to run to the one thing that's eternal and allow him to take over. And he wants to. So that's the second part of the message. God wants to bear our burdens. He wants to bear our needs. He wants to show us that he's able to do it. So like the disciples ran to him, he wanted to show them, look, I'm able to rebuke the winds and the waves in your life if you would run to me. And so that's what I've been doing. It's just, man, I don't know what else to do in this situation. I'm afraid. I'm this. I'm that. I got to run to Jesus. And he wants me to do it because he wants my faith to be encouraged.
Man, did you just give us the whole sermon for tomorrow? I think you might have.
Partially, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome, man. And where did you say again that you'll be talking about that, where you'll be giving your sermon tomorrow on YouTube?
I'll be live on, I think it's Jump Ministries Global Church YouTube page. And also you can check it out at jgntv.org, I think, .com or .org for it live. I think it's going to be at 7:30.
Gotcha.
That's
cool.
Awesome, man. Something that you mentioned just a few moments ago, you're really, you know, making a reference to where you're drawing your identity from.
Yeah.
Right? If you're drawing your identity from your job or from your financial situation, this storm, you know, that you refer to, that we're all in right now, it's really easy for the enemy to come in and steal your peace if that's where you're finding your identity. So before we get into the rapid fire questions, the last question I wanted to ask you is, what would you say is, you know, we're going to be releasing this on Friday, on Good Friday, the day that Jesus was crucified and died for our sins. And then we're also going to head into the celebration of Easter Sunday, this coming Sunday. So for people that may never heard the gospel, or people, you know, you mentioned that people think that you have to give all of these things up for Christ. But what they don't realize is what Christ is really going to give you in return. So for people that have maybe never heard the gospel, can you just as quickly or in as many words as you would like, explain that to the people? Because we could say it all day, but coming from you, it just means so much more.
Yeah, I would say that the gospel is simple to me in the sense that it's, man, taste and see that the Lord is good. And that's a verse that's in the Bible. God is giving us a promise that if you try me out, if you taste me, you will see that I'm good. And that's what I've done in my own life. And I'm sure you guys have done that as well. But the human condition, universal, everybody's struggling. Everybody's going through something that is impacting them, some things from their childhood, some things that is making life tough. But God wants to carry that burden. He says, come to me, all who are weary and heavy burden, and I will give you rest. And that's exactly what the gospel is. The gospel is we are apart from God because of things that have happened throughout history and in our own lives. But God is extending that grace and that mercy in his son who died for us, that in that we would find who we are as people. You said it perfectly, that people find their identity in things that their identity shouldn't be in. Right. People really do take their lives. People really do kill themselves over a lost business or something that they had all of their identity in. And once that was stripped from them, they felt like they were worthless. But if you would turn to God's word, and God says that you were fearfully and wonderfully made. And I know for me, a big part, I'm sure you gentlemen can attest to that, is like my manhood. A big part about me coming to Christ and him being able to shape who I am as a man. My identity is not my jump shot. My identity is not the money in my bank account or the woman that's on my arm. My identity is founded in who God says I am. So you can take all of that away. And, you know, I can never make another shot. That doesn't make me less of a man. It doesn't make me less of a human being. And it wouldn't affect me in the way that it might affect somebody else that has their identity in their jump shot. So like I said, just taste and see that the Lord is good. The big part about it is a lot of people, they have to get to the end of themselves. And that's what it was for me. I had to come to a place where I'm like, man, I'm living in a way that I don't like. I don't like myself. And I need change. And that's exactly, Jesus is there with open arms waiting. He says, I stand at the door of your heart and knock. And if you would open up and allow me to come in and eat with you, he will.
Beautifully said, man. I'm going to take the segue here where you mentioned that your identity is not your jump shot. However, fans have, or David Steele especially, has given you the identity of the Minister of Defense. Had it not been for that freak injury in Washington on New Year's Day, we are completely convinced that not only would you have been first, you know, defensive team All-NBA, but you would have been a candidate for Defensive Player of the Year. We're going to take this opportunity to switch gears here, make the conversation a little bit more lighthearted. We're going to get into some rapid-fire questions here. Luke, do you want to take the first one?
Yeah, so Jonathan, I discovered this because I don't know if you remember the group Freedaps, the freestyle rapping group that came to Media Day. Yeah, so they came to Media Day, it was a couple years ago, I think. And fun fact, I was one of the cameramen behind one of those cameras that was filming. Yeah. So in that moment, I had been interning with the Lakeland Magic, and they sent me to Orlando for Media Day. That was like my first real duty that they gave me, which was a pretty easy first day and a pretty fun one too, as you came to find out with, you know, guys, they interviewed you and freestyle rapped with your answers interwoven in their rap. But one thing you said that we wanted to touch on was you said that your unrealistic dream job was to be a zookeeper. And that was because you are scared of animals. And so just wanted to ask you in relation to that. I think did we lose him?
Oh, his computer died.
Oh, boy. He's at 1 sec. All right. In that interview, you said your unrealistic dream job is to be a zookeeper. And you said the reason that you aren't is mainly because you're deathly afraid of those animals. Yeah. So with that being said, kind of connecting the zookeeper part to a show on Netflix that's become a phenomenon is Tiger King.
I started it. I didn't finish it.
You started it. You're in for quite the roller coaster. Really? Jonathan and I were talking about it the other day on one of our podcasts, and was saying, like, with every episode, it gets weirder and weirder, and you just kept waiting for someone to say it was a joke. If they feel like they're straight movie characters, someone scripted them. They're insane. The whole thing just gets...
I keep watching you. Y'all scare me.
You should definitely keep watching, because, you know, we're all quarantined and, you know, trying to stay home, and, you know, there's nothing else going on. So we that show is just crazy, but it's one of those shows that makes you feel better about yourself, I think. but it is pretty funny. So with that being said, you said you started it. How far into it are you?
Just a couple minutes. Once I started it, it already was weird to me, and I was like, I don't know.
You just give it a shot.
Okay.
Give it another shot. Right. And you can blame us if you ended up, you know, deeming it not a good watch. So yeah, it's an interesting show, one I've never seen before, that's for sure.
It seems like you've got some kind of tiger behind you there.
Yeah, I think it's a tiger. It is a tiger, yeah.
So you're already on the right track.
Okay, exactly.
Jonathan Isaac, Tiger King.
Right, exactly.
Perfect. So, Jonathan, next question. What is your favorite road city to play? And this can be for any reason. It could be the arena, the atmosphere, the food in the city. Just your favorite city to play in on the road.
I think my favorite city to play is Brooklyn. I feel like every time I've played in Brooklyn, I've had a good game. So that's part of why I like it. I like the arena a lot. I think it's real, like, tight, really closed in. I like arenas like that. My second favorite would be Memphis, not because of the game or anything like that, but they have a restaurant there called Flight. It's like a small plates restaurant where you can have, like, one meal is like three different plates of food, and it's like, it's really good. So we go there as a team every time we play in Memphis.
What kind of food is that? You said it's three different. It's everything.
They have the you know, the Southern, you know, style Memphis food, and then they have American and all types of fish and everything.
Huh. What's your go-to meal at Flight?
At Flight, they have – okay, so my three plates, they have chicken and waffles.
okay, respect.
I think it's like a shrimp and grits is one, and then there's like a bison that's really good on like a bed of like risotto.
Bison.
Wow. Yeah, real nice.
Nice.
That's crazy. But then next question we've got for you, Jonathan, is which game show do you think that you would have the best shot at winning? So that'd be Jeopardy, Wheel of Fortune, you know, Deal or No Deal. Out of those shows, not necessarily just those, but game shows, which one do you think you'd have the best chance of winning?
I was actually on Deal or No Deal.
We didn't want to bring it up.
we didn't want to.
It's okay. I was on there for a little spot. I was so nervous on it. It was my first time actually really like being on something.
When was that?
I think it was during my rookie year.
So that was like before you had done. Yeah, before you had done anything like that. I can imagine. And it didn't look like the hoop was the best. And
yeah, no excuses.
It was an awkward angle. Threw your depth perception off.
Right.
No excuses on my part. It is what it is. But just because I've interacted with that show, I feel like I'd be the best at that one, just because I kind of know what it's about.
Yeah. That's definitely a show that I watched a lot growing up. Howie Mandel, and he, you know, that show is just always so fun to me. And it didn't seem like you had to do much. You just relied on luck, and that's it. And so I feel like, yeah, that's definitely probably a popular answer, because things like Jeopardy, things like that, that takes a lot of studying.
You gotta think.
Whenever I think of game shows, I think back to like the old Nickelodeon stuff, like Double Dare, Guts. You know, climbing the aggro crag. I don't know if you guys watched that show back in the day.
Aggro crag, wow.
I'd be all over that. So, Jonathan, with Easter coming up, unfortunately, a lot of us, you know, especially you, your family might be, you know, spread around the country or whatever the case may be, not really able to have the traditional Easter dinner like we normally would. But at the Isaac household, what is typically, what has to be on the table for Easter dinner?
My mom makes really good macaroni and cheese. There's just a lot of cheese, a ridiculous amount of cheese. And this is maybe weird, I love plantains, like fried plantains.
You're speaking of the choir.
I have a chef now, so I have them with almost like every meal.
Are we talking sweet, or are we talking like the more potato, not as ripe plantains?
No, sweet.
Oh, sweet. Brother, that's the only way to go.
That's all day. You ask all my day. Wife, she tells me I'm going to turn into a plantain.
Oh, wow.
Dude, I love plantains. Yeah. If we ever hang out in person, plantains are getting thrown down.
You guys have any kids?
I do have a child and one on the way.
Oh, and then I have one on the way as well with my wife.
Let's go.
Yeah.
I always ask people that, like, do you have kids? Like, I love the just the idea of family and just a unit being together. So dope for you guys.
Yeah, man. Thank you. And
eventually we'll have a little, you know, Jonathan Isaac Jr. running around.
A little unicorn running around.
A little unicorn. That's
little
what it
unicorn.
Is.
That's it. And you did mention that if you were going to be any animal in that interview, that you'd be a unicorn, which is just so fitting. That's incredible.
I'd be a giraffe and a lion.
I hate to drive a wedge between my two guests here, but we've got a Seminole and we've got a Gator. I don't know if that was brought up.
Yeah, Jonathan, I graduated from the University of Florida a couple years ago. And was actually
before we start the interview.
No, listen, I couldn't.
We knew you'd hang up.
I had to wait. Yeah, man. And I saw you play in person in March Madness and at the Amway.
Okay.
I guess that probably would have been your first game in the Amway, correct?
Yep.
Before you even knew that you'd, you know, end up in Orlando. But also, while we're on this wasn't on the list. So, Jonathan, forgive me going off script here. But PlayStation or Xbox?
PlayStation.
Oh, yes, boy. Sir. See, that's me and so the Jonathan's
Xbox.
Jonathan and I are split on that, but we're very thankful that Call of Duty Warzone has cross-platforming, yes, where we can play with each other. So me and Jonathan have been playing a lot of COD during this quarantine. So I had to kind of see where you were at. That's unfortunate. I should have known the Jonathans were going to stick together on that answer, though.
Absolutely. All right, last question, Jonathan, before we let you go here. Now, you have one day. Now, we realize that you're fairly well off, so just take this question for what it's worth. You have one day to spend $1 million. You have to spend $1 million in one day. What do you do? What do you spend that million on?
Has to be on yourself.
Oh,
see. Can't give it away. Cannot give it away.
He was about to go there.
He was.
I have to spend it on myself.
It does not have to be a single purchase.
Yeah, I mean, I would probably take a trip somewhere, someplace really fancy. I don't know. I've never been to Dubai or maybe an island or something like that. Just spend a lot of the money on the trip itself, try to get the experience in. I'll do that.
That's awesome, man.
So, well, so you're definitely an experience over possession type person then.
Yep.
Yeah, I'd have to say I'm on the same boat as you for sure.
I'd buy a Bugatti. I would just buy a Bugatti. No, I'm just kidding. I definitely would buy
that's only like 300.
That's right.
Yeah, I don't even know that. I have no business looking at prices of Bugattis.
You said Bugatti. I don't know why I thought you said Bentley. No, Bugatti, that's your whole million.
Okay, well then there we go. I don't know about a Bentley either. If I had to buy anything, it'd be a 2014 Shelby Mustang. That's my dream car. But I buy that and then a bunch of other stuff. Yeah. Who knows? But Luke, do you have anything else for Jonathan before we let him go here?
No, man. I think we about touched everything.
Yeah, man. Thank you so much for your time, my man. Just coming on here, taking the time with us. Just continue to do what you're doing, man, not only on the court, but more importantly in the community, spreading the gospel. You're doing God's work, man. I know that you know that, but I just wanted to take a moment to encourage you. So thank you so much for coming on to the show. Welcome back anytime.
I appreciate you both, men of God. Thank you very much. Let's stay in touch.
Absolutely, man. Stay safe out there. Stay healthy. And hopefully we'll see you back on the court soon.
Let's do it. Cool.
All right, man. Thank you so much. Have a great day.
Peace.
See ya.